It is always great to be here with John. You know, I love that. You know, it's hard, very hard to follow John, so you know, it's very tough. So the way I try to make up for it is to wear one more piece of clothes. You know, just it's I hope that makes up for everything I will miss. And yesterday when I got here, I was very surprised at how light the security was here. So no police, no security services. You guys are national treasures for Australia. What if someone wants to destroy Australia, they would have come here and bombed all of us out. Imagine this. I'm very worried about this now. You are identified on the high list. Watch out. Wherever you go, be careful with yourselves, okay? And that's something you should be very careful. You are national treasure, and this is something really important. So you are the beginning of a new revolution. It's I really appreciate that. It's another thing I was thinking about, Marjorie and John, when you were talking about it. So what you would do? I came from the U.S. I hope, you know, Qantas would have a special channel for you guys. You know, we come down, well, yeah, you sell, you give them the content, we can watch each teacher, what do you do, 3 minutes, 5 minutes? I mean, they get to showcase fishes, cooking. You're doing much better than cooking, you know. They showcase those dresses, you know, what I call gown dress or wedding dresses, and how to cook better food. You do much more important things than cooking better food, right? You're a much better chef. You're the chef of the future, right? That's so. I really think you should get them doing something. I'm sure Qantas will do it. Another thing I was talking to Marjorie is that you could do another take over ABC or national TV show, run a TV show called "So You Think You Can Teach," a reality TV show. I think you can be great hosts and good judges. I think would you like that? And lastly, I think I should do. Find some mountains so you can carve your faces in, like Mount Rushmore, you know. That's going to last forever, I think. I'm really working for you. I'm trying to get how things going with you guys. But I don't like the name. I'm sorry about this. Hot means stop, as far as I can tell, right? You know, I know John wants to stop Akara. I mean, you know, Rob Randall. There are many things John said, let's start talking about it, right? John said, okay, let's start talking about hot. There's hot curriculum, hot napnan, hot many things, right? You know, but you got to start somewhere, you know. So I hope, as an exercise, can you come up with another acronym that means start? You're creative people. Give it a shot. You have expertise, not only experience. So what can come up? That means something, you know, we're hot and then we do something else. English is my second language. Don't look at me. I can't handle this stuff. It's too much pressure for me. I don't do this stuff. Okay. Don't look at me. Think about yourself. This is your language. Come with the idea? No? There's like students. You look at them. Not me. Not me, right? Not me. Anyone with the idea? What's the acronym be? Start, right? Oh, very good. What's your name? Jeanette. You are working for AITSL now. Thank you. You will be our PR person. Okay. All right. Okay. All right. By the way, I'm not joking because I really look at you as the most important individuals in this profession. On December 10th, Obama signed into law the new law that replaced No Child Left Behind in the U.S. I was speaking at the Learning Forward conference. I'm sure John has addressed that conference many times, right by National Harbor near Washington, D.C. And they were celebrating. They had the state superintendents, everybody. I went up there. I said, this will make no difference. I mean, or if any difference, perhaps something bad, like No Child Left Behind, like Race to the Top. You hear about all these major policies, is that, and it won't work. Because what really matters are the individual teachers working together. That's what matters. The profession has to move forward. And because we complain a lot about policies, we complain about our political leaders, we complain about them. Remember, their job is to mess up your life. Because remember, any election is about bringing new ideas. But a lot of to develop expertise takes time. Do you see what I mean? So every 3 years, 5 years, 5, 6 years, they come up with some new policy. They try to change you. Remember those things? But you as expertise have to drive the direction. So have you noticed how many changes you've done? By the way, every time I come to Australia, you have a new prime minister. You know, something like, or you have some premier someplace, somewhere. And that's why I'm trying to not come here as often as possible. And this is, because I don't want to cause any disability in Australia. This is, but you notice that, right? You notice, because you know, policies come and go, honestly. Again, that's really their job. Because you want the government to have some promises, right? You know, and once they get in, they will do something, and then they will go away, and they will do something else. So the education, when we blame politicians for their lack of understanding of education, it's unfair. They're not supposed to understand. Remember those things? But also, I want to blame you, too. Remember, they were once in your classroom. If you want to say anything, you didn't teach them well. I mean, I don't know. You didn't help them understand that either. So all of this, I think, is really, truly important to understand that your role is not, you know, really just to stop something. You will start something. And also your role of stabilizing the profession, you know, is very important. That is, we have to have a voice. When John was standing here, you know, seeing those important things, that is, you want to be able to do the same in your community, in your classroom, to your your fellow teachers, to those who are, you know, politicians who don't understand. You can go up there. There is expertise that needs to be respected. There is, you know, there are things that we have to, we understand better than you do. But do you have the confidence, the courage, and the ability to make sure that you are actually representing expert knowledge in this profession? That's what I call it. The change has to happen from you, okay? Change has to happen from you. Now, when John was making a list of all these things, I was really impressed. Because I was impressed, I think, there are two things John said that struck me as very important. One is about impact. You know your impact. You know, what is your impact? Impact in what areas? What can you do? The second thing is that I think John almost hinted that, to say that help students see themselves as teachers. You know, see themselves as teachers. That is, how do you grow students? That's something important. And so what I'm going to do today is to give you a little bit of challenge. When you feel you're so good, you know, when you're so feeling good about yourselves, you know. So I want to help you leaving this place feel a little bit bothered. Okay, so think about this. So somehow it's okay. Well, I thought I was great going to Adelaide. Now I'm coming back. I'm not that great. But trust me, being an expert is being able to even move towards next, you know, stage of greatness. You can't be great all the time. Growth mindset. You got to have problems. You think you're perfect now? Are you? Do you? Good, thank you. That's a sign of expertise. So maybe one of the AITSL requirement check of it. If you think you're great, probably should mark down. Some kind of humility might help. You know, by the way, I'm actually using a very Confucius approach today. I don't like Confucius himself, but you know, it's a long time ago. Nothing to do with me. But but Confucius had this great saying. You know this. Confucius has sayings about everything. Okay. Today, if you hear anything wise, if you don't know who to attribute to, it's either Confucius or Einstein. Okay, both of them works, or John Hattie, that kind of other one. Just okay. Well, John Hattie said this, it must be right. Okay, so the idea is about this. Think about yourself. Let's start with this. Confucius once said that, you know, perfect yourself, perfect your family, perfect your nation, then perfect the world. So now you are perfect. Teacher, you have expertise in your classroom. How do you spread that beyond your classroom? How do you help your school become better? That's like your family. How do you make your state become better? How do you make the world become, you know, better in that regard? So now those kind of things, I will see some challenges, the impact areas. What kind of impact can we make? We talk about equity, we talk about individuals, we talk about different things. So some of the new challenges, and yesterday, all over Asia, everybody was very sad, not because Zhang said don't go to China for new lessons, they're going to Shanghai. It's because of this thing. This thing came out, it's called AlphaGo. I don't know if you know about this. Google's computer beat one of the best top Go players in Asia, which is really sad. This is bigger than the Deep Blue beaten Kasparov 1997, almost 10 years ago. There's a big deal because how many of you guys play this game called Go? You do, right? Can you explain to them what it is? Sounds like an American racial game, Donald Trump idea, right? Just it's more of a race game. It's white versus black, right? It's the no. That's not in, that. But that's the basic idea. Is that the whole thing is that the potential moves is perhaps 10 times more complex than chess. You really have this 19 by 19 plots. And it's only white and black. There's no affinity role, just individuals. You just plot them. And there's different management. It's very complex. But now, a computer beat a human being. Okay? Now this is time for us to feel sad. This is worse than the computer beating the Jeopardy game. Remember those things? Why is this such a big deal? This is such a big for us to think about. I think education right now is at a very interesting time that how do we help our children to survive and thrive in the machine age, in the age of machines? Because this is something very important. Impact is that. So what's the game? How do you play the game? That in historically, human beings have been really, education a lot of times has been trying to turn human beings to do machines' jobs. That's the thing, right? So if you look at most of our education thinking traditionally, since Industrial Revolution, what has happened is that you look at most of our jobs are starting like this kind of job. Remember this kind of jobs? That's what most human jobs were like. Remember those, right? And then they become this kind of jobs. You remember this, right? And this kind of jobs. Look, this jobs. It's really, So this is what a lot of times we've been trying to prepare people to do jobs like that. And this is massive amount of jobs were like this. This is our traditional education was about turning human beings into machines. Now the machines come over to say, hey, that's my job, get away, get out. That was the thing, that's the idea. So then this is what we used to prepare. Accountants, lawyers, all those guys, basically the same thing. We prescribe, that's why I love when John said, get rid of a car. You didn't say that, it's just my interpretation, right? Okay. But stop talking about a car, okay, that's the idea. Stop talking about curriculum. But that's how we did, how we always start by thinking about education, start with prescribed outcomes. Remember those things? Always, and then with prescribed outcomes, let's say, we start by looking at the jobs we have, look at the society we have, so we go prescribed. So what kind of knowledge and skills will be required for you to perform that job? Remember those? Then you get a bunch of people who are fairly experienced and old together to talk about this. And powerful, if you know, the minister helps you to get on the kind of curriculum board. Remember, you describe. So you need math. You need science. You need literature. Remember those things? We prescribe them, then we give to schools. Say, okay, teach. And then we use something to assess. How far have you achieved? So teaching, in many ways, traditional teaching at least, have been really defined as that teaching has been really trivialized as a UPS delivering process. I got a package from Akara, you deliver to your students, and in the process I will assess, did this person receive it? So Akara does hand you the package, you deliver to your students, and Naplan comes to ask, did you receive that package okay? Wasn't it like that? Very much like that idea. Do you notice that? Right? I'm sorry. I'm trivial, but I'm leaving for U.S. tomorrow, so you can't find me after this. But don't tweet that out. Okay? It's because they might stop me. This is a national issue. But anyway, so now think about that idea. Right? We start by understanding what there's nothing wrong, but unfortunately, most of our prescription, when we study jobs, we look at existing jobs. We start from there. But a lot of times, these traditional jobs, I would tell you, are gone. That's by those machines. Machines are taking over a lot of jobs. So this is what is no news to us and to everybody. And you can talk, you know, this is very normal, right? So I think the Australian people are talking about, you're losing 5 million jobs in the next 10 years. 44% of Australian jobs will be replaced by machines. So what can you do? Your impact. So my mind, in my thinking, is always to say, the best way to beat machines is not to become more mechanical, is to become more human. So we should thank these machines for taking our jobs away. It is a miserable thing. You know, a lot of these jobs are miserable. You know, like think about the driver's car coming out that doesn't need a human driver. It's a good thing. But I'm sure that the taxi drivers, limousine drivers, bus drivers, they are not happy about it at all. They are not happy about it. But it's a good thing. You don't have to drive. Yesterday, I had to come from Newcastle to Sydney. I had this. By the way, actually, I'm going to tell you, to ask you to think, help me think about through this one. So I had a driver. She was extremely nice. Think about, you know, how do you measure effective expertise? She was extremely, extremely nice and talking, but she's just a bad driver. She get confused by Sydney roads. I got to get to the airport, otherwise I'll miss my flight. But she still very calm and talking. So think about when John was talking about effective teacher versus effective driver. But how do you assess? You know, if I assess on the dementia, be nice. She's very good. But my goal was to get to the airport, not trying to be with someone who is nice, you know. So think about your expertise being nice versus being driver. She would have been a good person if you kind of lost your dog you can chat with. That'd be nice. It's however, the story is this, is that it's a miserable job for her. It's a miserable job for her. So if I had a driver's car, the car would go with me. I would not have a kind of emotional kind, you know, I had a real emotional trauma because I can't tell her. She was so nervous. I said, just drive. I couldn't tell her that, you know. But if it's a dumb machine, I could just drive, you know. But anyway, so that was the problem. So now when the job is replaced, and there will be many, many jobs replaced. By the way, the teacher jobs will not be replaced unless you turn yourself into a mechanical job like a, you know, UPS delivery thing. UPS can deliver. It's going to be replaced by machines. That's one thing. So if we want to help our children to become more human, what kind of education can we deliver? What makes us more human than machines? You know, machines are, you can say this, repetitive, mechanical. Once you make one machine, you can make another. That's going to be replaced. Human beings are different. Human beings are, by themselves, very, very, very unique and diverse. So let me invite you to do this. I think I made you, many of you do this. Some of you may heard me this. You know about this, sing a song, and so you understand what I mean. So they may ask you, what are you going to do with this? You know Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer? Can you sing? Can you stand up, please? Okay, stand up. Okay, please. All right. Sorry, that's advertisement beginning. Okay, I got to go through this.
If I was Prime Minister, I would make it illegal. If I was a boy and I was you and I got handed more money.
Oh, I'll skip. I was going to do some advertisement. Okay. What? I did. An arrow carrier. Oh, so okay, forget about it. Don't sing the song. Stand there, sit down. Okay. No more songs. All right. Okay. Oh, you have it. Whew. So that's expertise. Right? I don't know what happened, but they may come, may not. Oh, good. Okay, this is good.
You know Dasher and Dancer and Prancer and Vixen, Comet and Cupid and Donner and Blitzen. But do
you can dance
recall
too.
The most famous reindeer of all? Rudolph the red-nosed reindeer had a very shiny nose. And if you ever saw it, you would even say it glows. All of the other reindeer used to laugh and call him names. They never let poor Rudolph join in any reindeer games.
All right, that's good enough. Thank you. Now I want to ask you this one. This about what are you going to do with Rudolph? What's wrong with Rudolph? Nobody wants to play with him. He did not meet the expectation. His nose was too red. His Naplan score was probably like, you know, like zero percentile. It was horrible because this standard. Remember, the curriculum requires his nose to be red, to be black. Right? So nobody wants to play with him. He's not normal. And he was put into special education. Remember that? That's the, we're going to try to change. Now, this is actually the first challenge of beating with machines. Because traditional education, we try to turn people into machines. We have a common curriculum for everybody. We have common standards for everybody. Everybody has to learn this at this time and to meet the needs. You know, for, so the need is described. So in order to do this job, you got to know this much literacy, this much math, and this much studies, social studies. And everybody has to do it and progress at the same time. Remember, that's how prescription is. And Rudolph was a problem in all those things. And but everybody is, in essence, a Rudolph in some way, right? Everybody is in some kind of, somewhere, somehow, you are not complying to the norm. That's why, you know, we have a recent talk about average, the concept of average, the end of average. And let me actually give you a little bit of a taste of this for you to think about judge people. So you look at this one. This is from Todd Rose. Which man is larger? What? Which one is larger? Who said that? You're so wise. No wonder you're hot, you know, but, you know. Okay. Oh, it depends on what you want to look at, right? That's right. It's so good. Why? There's so many dimensions. But in life, don't we try to bring back to average? We always ask that question, which one is a better student? Remember those things? Who is a better person? Remember those things? We say, it depends, right? It depends. And now in Rudolph, you know, Rudolph's problem is that his nose is way above average, or way below average, however you want to define that idea. And human beings are diverse in so many dimensions. Height, weight. And when John was talking about, who is the Australian Open the guy, who is the other guy you can't beat? I have no idea who that is. But anyway, apparently he's better than you in some domain than other things. But if you put him up to speak about this then, probably not, right? Okay. So that, like most of the natural variations in physics, in physical attributes, it doesn't really matter. Like height, you know, it just shouldn't matter naturally. But when you apply to specific tasks, it matters. Specific situations, it matters. Something, you know, for some things, height in tall people may be more valuable than short people. In other places, might not be. You know, gymnastics versus Australian football. You will select two different kind of people. Probably, I hope you do. You know, otherwise you'd be all messed up, right? You know? But then we have other kind of theories talk about how people are different. You know, we have heard about multiple intelligences. You guys have heard a lot about this Howard Gardner's idea. You know, a lot of we're different and smart, you know. We also have different emotions. You know, somehow we are not driven by the same kind of motivation. For example, we have some people driven by one thing or other things. This is the psychologist from Stephen Rice out of Ohio, for example. But we have 16 basic human motivations, but a percentage of us are driven by different things than others. We're not motivated by the same thing. This is called instinctual. Instinction, what you're looking for. You can always be taught and forced to follow certain things. You can always be forced. So never underestimate the power of nurture. We call it. It's not, you know, as John said, it's not surface or deep. It is and. In education, too, it's kind of nature via nurture. Nurture always expands or enhances or suppresses certain things. But if you look at this, and we are not driven by the same thing. Some people are more interested in power, trying to influence others. You know, some of your children always like to boss other people around. You notice that in a few of those kids, and others happy to say, fine, you do it, you know. And some of you are very much interested in knowledge. You want to know. Some of you are more curious than others. Some of your children are more curious than others. They are not equally driven by the same motivation. And some of you are more interested in order, organization things. You know, I don't know if you guys check on this one. You know, have you run into people who orderliness, organizing things is their passion? They come, you know, if they come as a guest, they come to your house, they help you clean your closet. You know, just have you run into those people? Or have you must have run into people who are just who gain energy and they like to color code everything. You notice this and the color coding, they do all those kind of stuff. It's having but some people can care less. They can have a mess and they are happy to live in a mess, right? It's and some others, for example, very much driven by idea of honor. Some people in saving things. Some people into very much social contact. They get energy by have companionship. Not everybody. You trust me. Not, you know, some young people wouldn't go to the restroom by themselves. They just let's come and go together. You know, just it's but others they would do everything on their own unless they're forced to do it. You notice that and so this is something really important to understand about individual differences. We call your talent in the music, talent in the arts. Again, this is not to defy the idea of growth mindset. You can learn anything, but how fast you can learn in a certain domain and how far you can go makes a big difference. You know, for example, for me, no matter how hard I try, I will never become a successful professional Australian football player. I can learn. I will bet I can if I spend 10,000 hours on trying that thing, I might be able to kick the ball somewhere, you know, but I don't think it's going to do much to me, right? So also do not really assume people have the same motivation. The motivation is about gaining energy. So a lot of times, if you understand this, you will have better social relationship with your spouses too, by the way. If it's, don't force them to do the same thing. For example, physical activity is one area I used to, I never understood until I read this theory, really. Like, I live in Eugene, Oregon, where you know we have a lot of people running around. You know, that's Nike. That's the birthplace of Nike. We call Tracktown, USA. If you come to Eugene, Oregon, you see people running all the time for no purpose. They just run around. They run around. You know, in my village, where I grew up in China, I grew up in a village, we run for a purpose. We run towards something good or run away from something bad. But these people run in a circle. And they say, why? Why do you do that? Exercise their body. You say, they want to move around, you know, they gain energy. So what all of this, physical attributes, multiple intelligence, or many other domains we can vary, these are born, but then you think about your family backgrounds, immigrant family, poor families. They have different cultures. Different cultures. And those nature, those nurture environments provides a very different kind of things and can affect all these variations too. And because any of this human potential is just a potential. It needs the environment to realize. It needs teachers, needs classrooms, needs families, and families actually can alter a lot. You may have a great potential in being a musician. You know, so occasionally I thought I could have become a Justin Bieber and never got there, you know, because when I was growing up in my village, I had no music. There's never a way to trigger that possibility, right? Another thing is culturally, there are certain things we value more, certain things we don't value at all. When you don't value something, you're not given the opportunity even to practice that. And also then, how much time do you spend on those things, right? And, you know, we know the general rule that John is absolutely right. You know, no matter how smart you are, without efforts, you're not getting anywhere. You're not getting anywhere. Efforts. 10,000 hours, that's the generic Malcolm Gladwell rule for people. It may be 5,000, maybe 10,000, maybe 3. It's a lot of time. You want to be good at something. That's it. So does your school, does your classroom, or does your community give your students enough time to develop the strength? And then finally, also, do you get rewarded for what you do in many ways? So let's go back to Rudolph. Okay, this is what we have in our schools. Our children come here, right? This is what we have. Every one of these Rudolph, they're great in some area, except in some domain. But remember, we have all this. This, in the traditional paradigm of education, is a nuisance. because they are too different. Remember those things? Too different. Because our result, the education result, was something similar. Was something similar, because that's a nuisance. We don't want them. So he's trying to homogenize and get rid of that. That was the idea, because we want an education that turns these children into machines. Remember those things? So now our challenge is that, what are you going to do? So when Rudolf comes to your school, do you fix, do you try to paint the nose black, or do you try to make it redder? But that has to do with judgment. You know, what you want our education outcome to be. And fortunately, the era like this is gone. Like AlphaGo player, the Google, you know, driverless car, you know, think about the driverless car of Google. Everything is gone, and human beings are liberated from those mechanical jobs now. So how can we help our children grow in a different way? You remember the following story, the ending of Rudolph is a happy story, right? So on one foggy Christmas Eve, remember that? Santa Claus was looking for a GPS. And he found Rudolph. Remember those things? And luckily, remediation did not work, and his nose still is red, and he is of value. So in education and policies, we always talk about how machines are taking our jobs away, we need to diverse our industry, we want to help our children to become better employees, finding the new jobs, all those kind of arguments. But actually, what's going to be important to understand is not the jobs that's been disappearing, is the jobs that our children can create. It is the opportunities now for every child to actually have value. The foggy Christmas Eve has arrived. So I always like to look at the new opportunities. When I look at the Google car, I don't look at the taxi driver's gone. I don't look at, actually, with a Google driverless car, you don't even need police anymore. Do you know that on the road? Because they have nobody to arrest. You can drink and drive, you know. You don't even drive, you know, just you can do whatever you like. But anyway, so think about this idea. I look at the opportunities this can create. I look at maybe car interior designers. Because now you don't need to drive a car, you can put a hot tub inside. So those people from Perth, anyone from Perth? Oh, yeah. So next time if we meet here, you'll be in a car that's a hot tub, a conference, you come here, you don't need to fly anymore. Remember those things? You can have chef within. So imagine what you can do within the car. The new possibilities. So let's dream about the new possibilities. What kind of new possibilities we have? And why everybody is become valuable. Every little potential talent becomes valuable. Daniel Pink has this idea called, we have now arrived in the age of abundance. There are still many, many poor people. Many poor people. Okay, don't forget that. But there has been a great increase in wealth and leisure time in many developed countries. So many of you here today, including China, actually not a lot more people have a lot more disposable income and leisure time. Do you notice that? We have more disposable income and leisure time. What do you do with that? You consume different things. I came from a village in China. This is the house I was born into. My father still lives there. If I look at this house there, everything in that village, people struggle for necessities. Every day. Rain every day, 24 hours a day, they are worried about food, shelter, and clothing. That's worried. But today in Australia, very few people worry about that. That's, even the so-called poor Chinese people don't have to worry about the basics anymore. So you worry about a different kind of consumption. What do you consume? You consume psychological and spiritual and moral and aesthetic products. You consume something that's very psychological. Psychological is very much very personal. Therefore, everybody, once we get here, we consume very different things. So we have entered the age of personalized consumption. Personalized consumption, it means we want choice. Anything, if you can create choice, you create value. And do you know about the meaning of choices? It's amazing. Look at you. Everybody has choice. You get, how many choices you have there? Everybody wants choice. And just to illustrate the point, this was the age of necessity. I lived in China. I had one bar of soap to wash every inch of my body. That was great, fine. But then when I went to America, 1992, I tried to buy something to wash my hair. You look at it. I couldn't buy anything to wash my hair because I did not know what kind of hair I had. Do you want oily, normal, or dry? Do you know? Now, what do you buy? What do you do? You talk to your hairdresser, right? Yeah, that's a new profession. That's what it's called, hair consultant. You know, that's what it's. We have those people now. I just want you to look at this. This thing. To make this versus this, we use a lot more different talents in this domain. Do you notice that? We want choice. Those who are able to create choice, come up with choices. Actually, computers normally cannot do that. They may come up with choices, but still the human eye to pick which bottle might sell better. Do you notice that? This is why the big difference is that. Now you create talents. Art, design, visual, people understand colors, math, scientists, readers, those who love to organize things, all have a job here. Do you notice this thing? Those who are good at dancing in your school actually have to have a job selling shampoo as well. You know those? Have you seen that shampoo commercial without anyone dancing with it? Which actually almost taught me I got to wash my hair and dance. That was something. I went to look and said, okay, all right. This is the big shift. The foggy Christmas Eve has arrived. Today, it is true. Traditional undervalued talents have become valuable. Daniel Pink said it's the right brain. I don't really believe the right brain. I believe the full spectrum of human potential has become valuable. That's the full spectrum. So we do not try to homogenize. Remember, try to beat with machines. You cannot continue to homogenize and teach people to become mediocre. Instead, you want every talent to become great in different domains. So how, as teachers, as great teachers, as highly accomplished lead teachers, what can we do to help every child to become great? Look at the strength, even immigrant children. And look at immigrant children coming from China, from Asia, from any place. Look at it. They have huge resilience. They may not read the language, but they have a lot more things to work on. So that how do we help them become great? I was talking to two students from China. They studied in the U.S., spent 4 years in the U.S. They said, I can't find a job in the U.S., can't find a job in China. I said, why don't you create a job? Because you know a lot more than most people. Your strength is understand two cultures, two education systems. Because they were trying to look for the monocultural place. As how do you help us develop new things? And so this is the challenge. When traditionally undervalued talents become valuable, when traditionally useless people become useful, it changes a lot of things. My best example of the traditionally useless people now become useful is Kim Kardashian. Many people hate her. Actually, there's some, because the reason I use her is precisely because people hate her. That's why I use this example. Because you look at her, what does she do? She does nothing, really. She's what I call celebrity for nothing. You know, she is famous for being well-known. That's the only thing she does, right? But now you come to understand it. She is just no different than a shampoo bottle. She's just another alternative of human desire. People want something. You know, you buy this green bottle versus the yellow bottle. People like, you know, Kardashian versus whoever, that Australian Open person, they think I'm crazy to compare this to. You know, what, Fedoro? Okay, think about it. They are the same, they satisfy some psychological needs. But that psychological needs is very personal. So 1 out of 10,000 people may like her. Maybe 1 out of 1 million people like her. If she lived in a traditional society, isolated in village, it would be useless. She would be useless in my village. You know, she can't take the water buffalo out. You know, that's the stuff. But now, because she appeals to a very small percentage of people, very small percentage of people, but she could reach 1 billion, 2 billion people on the globe because of technology. Therefore, suddenly she gained value. That's what we call, we consume small things. So now the thing for you to just help you imagine this. If Kim Kardashian is useful, anyone can be useful. But the challenge for you to think about is this. How do you help all our children become great? I don't really have answers to this one. How do you help each one of this person becoming their own best? That is what Todd Rose wrote this book. It's really fabulous, called The End of Average. This is a book is worth reading, and he talks about how a jagged human profile. That is actually, because in the traditional education, remember our old model, we talk about the same profile of success for every individual. Remember, that's what we talk about. So you need this math, the literacy, reading, you know, look at Australian curriculum. We want everybody to have the same body of knowledge to be equally good in those areas. But we talk about it in a new way, talk about the success of individuals is jagged profile. You may be really bad in certain areas, and believe me, accept that, and run away from what you're not good at towards something you're good at. You know, that is actually my entire life. I have lessons to tell you. My entire life has been about running away from what you're bad at. I was a horrible, horrible farm boy in my village. I couldn't take rain. I couldn't drive the water buffalo, couldn't climb the trees. So my father said, just go away. Go to school or something like that. And if he had tried to give me remedial lessons on driving the water buffalo, I would still be a miserable, failed, worst Chinese peasant. Really, I was thinking, I'm not joking. The real story is my son, I encourage all my family to. My son now is 25. He went to University of Chicago, trying to be a good Chinese boy, studying economics. If you want to go study economics, that's the best place. You know, I think out of the 50-some live Nobel laureates in economics, they have over 20-some, you know, over there. So he studied 2 years, but after 2 years, he said, Dad, I'm not going to do economics anymore. I said, why? He said, there are too many Asians in economics. And I said, no, tell me the real reason. He said, well, my math is not as good as theirs. I said, hey, good. Get out. Do something else. I said, then what are you going to do? He said, I'm going to study art. Okay. I said, art is very un-Chinese. Okay. But so he picked art history, and just last week, he was happily employed studying art history. He enjoys, he's a very good art historian. Now, just last week, he was admitted with full scholarship to study art history at Stanford, PhD. And so this is, so I'm happy to have a very happy, good art historian than a miserable, a lousy, a crappy economist. Remember those things? So this is something, how do you help your children, students, your Rudolphs come to school, to help them as individuals? This is called the education creates opportunities for individuals. Individual students, look at them. That's when I was really appreciative when John was talking about, it's not how to teach, it's the good teachers. How do we shift that role? As you do not really teach the necessary curriculum, you help individual grow. And this would demand you have a different way to demonstrate your impact. What's your impact? Remember, traditional impact in education is normally about how well you've homogenized everybody, how successfully you have moved everyone together on the same trend, but now how well have you been able to cultivate individual differences? How do you measure? How do you support that? And that's something, by the way, if you look globally speaking, when you measure homogenization, this is why China or East Asian countries have done very well on international testing, because they're very good at homogenizing people. And the traditional measures of things we measure as how well the homogenous individuals. If you measure how well they have educated people to be different, they're not very good. That's why China complains they don't have the creativity, the entrepreneurs, the inventors they need. Because those were deviate, they're different from others, all those things. The second thing that I want to challenge you a little bit to think about is that before you think about, you're done with me, I want to challenge you to think about another one, is the idea about, think about side effects in education. Side effects, what do you gain and what do you lose in teaching, okay? This is they start with this. People always arguing about creativity. You know, no, people think creativity is absolutely important. By the way, creativity has not been important until very recent years. Actually, until the 1990s, people even didn't write about creativity. I was looking at Google. So how often is creativity mentioned in the millions of Google books? By the way, if you're teaching history, this is something fun to play with. If you want to say how a concept how frequently the concept has appeared in Google books. Google's, you know, archives millions of books. So you look at this, I typed in creativity. Creativity was beginning to be mentioned after 1920 and began to grow after 1980s. And if you compare to the concept of they are typing students, children. You count how many mentions of children in the Google books, all these volumes of books, how little creativity was talked about. You notice this? If you type in school, the same thing. You know, we have lots more writing about school and students, children, than about creativity. Creativity doesn't become important because for a long time, creativity is not important, not for the masses. Creative people do not obey rules very well. Creative people always trying to do something different, you know, in many ways. And Lady Gaga would have been useless for Henry Ford. Think about that, right? Yes, don't you think? Still would have Steve Jobs. So now creativity suddenly becomes important. People began to play with the concept. But then the good news is that everybody is creative. We are born. That's actually the human capacity. Human beings can create. The only way we can do to beat other species is we can learn. We are born with a capacity to learn. A learning process is a creative process. You know, machines like this, I'm not afraid of these machines. I'm afraid if one of these machines says, I quit. That's become very concerning, right? The machines, that means is learning about something. I don't like this job anymore. That's going to be very dangerous. That's something. So, because this machine cannot be creative, cannot assemble new information necessarily at the same level. By the way, they're talking about AI, artificial intelligence, might be able to get that level, but by far not able to do that. So human beings are born creative, but somehow in life, we lose that creativity as we age. This is 1970s basic data. There are many ways to measure creativity. This is just one way, okay? It's called divergent thinking. You know, it's not truly, this may or may not have nothing to do with if you have become a creative person or not. This is just your capacity to come up with new possibilities called divergent thinking. So at age 5, 98% of our children are creative at the genius level. It means everybody is creative at genius level. That's us. That's human beings. That's what we do. It's the same thing when you are born in China, you learn Chinese. And you're born in Australia, you learn English. Why? Because you are equipped with the capacity to create new hypotheses, new possibilities, learn something new. Because God, I don't know if you guys believe in God, or Darwin, whatever you believe, whichever version you like, is that we're equipped with the potential. I mean, if God didn't know where you're going to be born, okay? And so if he had to, you know, give you the wrong chip, you only speak English, but born in China, that would be a disaster, right? So that's why you only have the capacity to learn. We all have the capacity to learn. And after 5 years in our schools, especially in school, we lose about 60% of students at the same level. And this happens more in those schools without a HALT, you know, that's something, okay, so think about, without you, it's worse. And we continue to decline. So this is one of the issues called side effects. The more you learn about something, the less likely you'll be creative. Because a lot of times, when you repeat something, you form a very efficient way of doing things. Then you're more likely to do that. If some of the neuroscience talk about this, how do you become expert? Expertise means that you do the same thing. Many times, you grow that. But then how do you challenge that? Also, in our teaching, there's some research showing this. The earlier and the faster you teach children something, and they may lose creativity very quickly. And that's direct teaching can enhance short-term outcomes, but can damage children's curiosity and creativity. You guys, there's two big studies embedded in this blog. You write this down, go to Slate, search for it. It's worth reading. It's very much worth reading about why direct instruction. So as teachers, my challenge to you is that, do you ever consider, when you celebrate your short-term gains, short-term impact, that you might have lost something? This is why I'm sometimes very critical of the US model when I try to force students to improve their reading by this time. You might have improved your NAPLAN scores on reading in short term, but they might have lost something. You know, this idea about side effects, In medicine, we always talk about medicine. Medicine, when we try to copy medical research, mostly from a methodological perspective, I think the most important lesson to learn from medicine is the philosophy of side effects. In medicine, you have to disclose both the effectiveness, what it can do, and also the potential damages. You know, when it cures, it can hurt. That's in medicine. So when you buy medicine, you always receive a warning label. Remember those? This is Tylenol, cures your runny nose, but may cause a bleeding stomach. Have you read those things? Okay. But in education, have you received warning labels like that? This reading program may improve your students' NAPLAN scores on reading, but may make your children hate reading forever. Have you seen those things? So think about what we might do, the long-term versus short-term damages. And then if you are interested in any of what I was talking about, this kind of things, I laid out about the assessment impact in a book with my students. It's not the best book, but it's an interesting book because I wrote it. And but it's called Counting What Counts. It's really laid out a lot of the theorist argument to say what matters and how they may or may not work together. You know, what can change, what we cannot change in terms of impact. And finally, I think I want to talk a little bit about the idea of equity. You know, teachers, the challenge of new ideas for equity. Because we talk about equity coming from traditional measure of equity, we talk about family, income, parental education, communities, all kinds of issues. But we also talk about equity based on talent. I think we seem to have legalized discrimination based on individual cognitive styles, cognitive talents. We favor those and those families who can produce better readers and better math people in the beginning years, and we disadvantage others from other places. So that's the. So as we address equity, the traditional paradigm has very little hope to truly close the so-called achievement gap, because those kids come to school who can read come from certain families, and then that's going to be perpetuated. Then you will use those drives the AITSL scores, graduation, go to college. I think we have to shift to change, to rethink about, you know, certain all skills become valuable, all talents become valuable. We need to rethink about how we as teachers can lead the shift to rethink about every student is valuable. We do not prejudge them. We do not force them to close the gap that may or may not even be closed. And also by closing those gaps, we might have sacrificed students the opportunities to grow in their own ways. You notice that, you know, like when you are trying to provide excessive training or tutoring to some student, you might be holding them back. Let's give you another example. Michael Phelps is a great American swimmer. Remember this? I think he had ADHD. He would not have been the best reader. He's come out of Baltimore. If you want to fix him on reading, make sure he could read before he could go practice swimming, he would still be hooked on phonics in some basement. And you think about that, right? That's right. So now I want to come back. Everything brings everything back together. What does this mean? This challenge is this. You have been great. You have been leaders. But one of the dangers that being an expert in some domain is the burden of success. You've been so successful, it's more likely for you to repeat what you did. Okay? Also, you've been successful in the paradigm. I think when Brown and Clinton and Marge, when they asked me to talk about this, I said I want to address a big question. Many people are talking about we need a school transformation. Improvement doesn't work, but we continue to improve. So when you as teachers, are you able to truly transform, or are you only able to improve? Because a lot of people say the education system cannot reinvent themselves. That's why a lot of people say, let's introduce new players, new people, new system, doing charter schools, companies, privatization, all those things, because they don't believe we can transform within. And they believe us more like this Nokia phone. Remember that look at this Nokia phones? How many phones? Nokia was adding smartphone features, but ultimately did not transform fast enough to become a smartphone. So they were adding smartphone features on a dumb phone system. And they were eventually replaced by the smartphone. Okay. So today I was laying some challenges. which may or may not even be correct. But I want to challenge you to say, do you have the confidence, do you have the courage to reinvent ourselves, to serve every child, to support their strength, to enhance their strength, to go support their passion, to hold them accountable for being great in their own domain, to hold them accountable for being creative and entrepreneur, to help them to take advantage of the opportunities created by technology instead of trying to become victims of technology advancement, to help them to create their jobs, not to look for jobs. Thank you.